it sure has been a while and a lot of crazy stuff has happened. I missed you all so much. But I'll talk about that in status 456, so let's just get to the topic, shall we? So, animation, for our intents and purposes, is basically when something arbitrarily transforms its position or maybe orientation through time. In other words, if a box falls due to gravity, it's not animation. But if a box moves because some animator specified positions at certain time points, then yeah, that is 100% animation. Now here's the question, how do animators do that? Well, allow me to introduce you to a couple of concepts, bones and keyframes. Bones are objects that can be used to sort of bend and distort a mesh in various ways. Here's an example in Blender, I have a hierarchy of bones here.
Prestani da lupaš!
I have a hierarchy of bones here, and you can kind of see that they're logically connected or attached to each other, forming some sort of hierarchy. If I supply a mesh here and determine which parts are affected by which bone, then I can effectively bend this mesh to my literal will. Alright, so what are keyframes then? Well, keyframes are basically time points with some transformation data. For example, a bone can be on very specific coordinates at a very specific time point. If you have multiple of these keyframes in a sequence of some sorts, then you essentially have a complete animation. Now, animations can have names, frame rate, duration or length, and various other properties. Models in Half-Life can also have special bone properties like hitboxes and attachments and controllers, but there will be more on that in the next video. Or well, at least in the upcoming videos, because there's a lot of different stuff I gotta cover. But anyway, now you know a little bit about animations in general and how Gold Source might be working with them. But implementation details are not exactly what we're here for, at least not in this very series. You see, what made Half-Life truly outstanding back in the 90s is how it seamlessly combined animation and gameplay. This means you can basically attach things onto specific bones and an NPC, like a hat for instance, or a weapon. You can have attachments that have some real in-game functionality. It allows for fancy, and I mean very fancy things, like imagine an alien grunt with turrets on its shoulders. Half-Life's skeletal animation system lets you do just that. Let's first take a look at entvars. That's where all the animation variables are. And we've got comments for once. So handy. Sequence is the animation ID, basically. It's a number. There's animation 0 might be running or walking. It depends on each model. Gate sequence is like a secondary animation layer. It's used to animate the player's legs so they can run and shoot simultaneously. Sven Co-op implements them for monsters also. I will skip the rest, because they're not really that important right now, and only mention that frame rate is actually a multiplier. So this means if your animation in your model is at 30 FPS, a frame rate of 2 will make it run at 60 FPS and so on. Let's also jump into a model viewer and open up barney.mdl. I recommend Half-Life Asset Manager, or at least Solo Killer's Half-Life Model Viewer if you can't run that, and look at the Sequences tab, you'll see a bunch of animation names. Notice that they're all ordered, so a sequence number would actually correspond to one of these. For example, idle 1 is 0 and run is 5. Alright, so let's write an entity and try doing something with this new information. You might be coming from a modern engine and saying something like, but wait, how on earth am I supposed to manage all of that by myself? Surely I won't be manually setting pev frame every couple of milliseconds, like, and how do I find animations by name? Where's the animation graph? Where is everything else? Well, don't worry, bud. The SDK has you covered. Yup, we're covering a new base class, everybody. Time to move on from CBase entity to something more advanced. And that something is CBase animating. Until now, you've been inheriting from CBase Entity, but now we're doing CBase Animating. If you peek the definition of it, it's obvious that CBase Animating inherits from CBase Delay, and ultimately that inherits from CBase Entity. And this is pretty much the definition of a class hierarchy. If this is new to you, what I want you to understand is that someone else wrote all of this to make life easier. CBase Animating has a bunch of utilities for finding animations by name, setting body groups, obtaining the frame rate from an animation, and stuff like that. It's all done for you. All you gotta do is use it. So now that we have a basic little entity here using Barney as our test model, which can also update itself every once in a while, it's time to do some basic animation stuff. So, if you go ahead and suddenly try setting the animation like so, using lookup sequence, you'll be disappointed to find out that it doesn't actually do anything. If you paid attention in the entity properties video, you would know that all of the variables in PEV are always zero, so PEV frame by default is going to be zero. So we would need to increase it in the think method. Let's actually cobble something up, shall we? Basically, every fraction of a second, we're just gonna increase the frame, and if it goes above 255, we roll it back to zero, so it keeps going up, it's basically looping. Alright, we got something now, but I did say earlier that CBase animating provides a lot of utilities. You see, frame rate is currently zero, and anim time is zero, and a bunch of other relevant properties are zero, so we should probably initialize them with something. Ah, yes. Put this into your spawn method. Reset sequence info will basically extract frame rate information from the current animation. So make sure you call it after you've set PEV sequence. And now, in the think method, just call studio frame advance. Without any parameters. It's gonna automatically advance the playback position with respect to how you adjust PEV next think. Internally, it's gonna do a bunch of logic to increase PEV frame depending on frame rate and time intervals and everything else. If you're curious, you can find out how functions from CBase animating are used by looking at the cycler entity code as well as all NPCs. Peek the definition of CBase animating, pick some method you're interested in, and right-click it and find all references. That's how you learn code. That's like, you know, you gotta start doing that if you haven't already. You might wonder if any of this is applicable to sprites and brush models, and yes, a part of it actually is. For instance, if we load a sprite instead of a model, we're able to change PEV frame, and that's about it. PEV frame becomes an actual frame number, no longer a percentage. You gotta use the model frames macro to find out how many frames a sprite has got, like this. You gotta pass the model index to it, and of course, the model has to be set already. And know that this one only works in sprites, that is the model frames macro. With brush entities, I think you can only flip between 0 and 1, but I haven't really done much with that, so that's gonna be something for another time. Anyway, there's a couple of last things I want to show, and that is skins and body groups. Skins are literally just swapping out textures. The best example of that is the soda can model. It has 6 different textures. We don't need CBase animating for that. We'll just write an entity that loops PEV skin from 0 to 5 and back. For some nice vibes, we're also gonna make it spin with a velocity. Give it 30 degrees per second on pitch and yaw. That's gonna be it. Now, body groups are a step above skins in complexity, because each body group can have its own body. You cannot choose individual textures, but with bodies, or body parts, or body groups, whatever they're called in here, you can. You can change them separately, you can change out weapons for other weapons, you can change out heads, you can change out hats, and so on. With skin, you can do that. So this is why I want you to take a look at the scientist model, precisely its body groups. Go to the body parts tab and see this first section here. It says studio. That's your main body group, and this usually only has one body. So the studio body group is at index 0. Just keep that in mind. Moving on to the next. Heads are body group index 1. In this very instance, each model can define their own. But in this case, in the scientist model, heads are number 1. It has 4 different submodels, i.e. bodies. So the first head would be body group 1, body 0. The second head would be body group 1, body 1. The same goes for the other ones. The third head would be body 2, the fourth head would be body 3. I think you get the idea by now. So if you wrote something like this in the code, you would suddenly get the head of this guy. For the end, here's some homework. And here are some entity and model ideas if you're a modeler. Alright. I think I've shown you everything I plan to do for this one. In the upcoming videos, we're gonna cover attachments, rotating individual bones using bone controllers, checking which part of the model was hit via hitboxes, and how to handle animation events, which are a super powerful aspect of the animation system. And until then, happy programming!